is there any evidence that the next generation of leadership is different? Or, as some have said to me, no, not that much. Yeah. You've got to wait for the generation after this generation. Yes.
I think I'm more in that latter camp. I mean, certainly there's different personalities, and it matters that the current leaders, Hu Jintao and Wen Jiabao, that they were different from Jiang Zemin and the predecessors. They're more engineers, these current ones. They were trained in the poor parts of the country. Right. And so in the next generation, presumably led by Xi Jinping, they're different too, more of a kind of coastal heritage, more of a princeling heritage within China. Whether that will matter to us, nobody's made a convincing case to me that the people are more important than the system. The system now still seems more powerful than these new characters.
What about this notion that it goes too far? I mean, the paranoia.
Right.
I mean, why would you imprison your most famous artist?
Suppose you were in charge of PR for the Communist Party of China. Let's transport you there to Beijing, and they're going to give you carte blanche. The first thing you would do is to have them not...
I'd like to be in charge, not in PR. But.
just have them release basically everybody who's in jail now.
Right.
What they did with the Nobel Prize, when Liu Xiaobo won the Nobel Peace Prize...
Even a better case.
Yes, they essentially documented, after his selection, all the reasons why he was chosen. They locked him up, they wouldn't let his wife or family go to the ceremony, they cut off diplomatic relations with any country that did go to the ceremony, as opposed to just saying, it's a big tent, you know, you choose who you want, we're going to try to run things our way. So there is a kind of reflexive, thin-skinned, own worst enemy immaturity to a lot of the leadership that shows up in these ways.
They want to protect themselves, they want to be a global power, they want to have a navy that, you know, that extends their reach, but they're not imperialist or they are not proselytizers.
Yes.
For their way of life or for their philosophy or for Confucius or for anything else.
I think the main dissenters to that view are people in Tibet and Xinjiang
and
that are the periphery of China. But apart from...
But that's power, isn't it?
Yes, it's power and it's their sense of manifest destiny.
Right.
If you ask anybody in China, they'll say, oh, of course, Tibet has always been part of China, et cetera, et cetera. So from their perspective, that's territorial wholeness. But when it comes to... you know, having some gospel for the rest of the world, that really is not part of the history of China or much of what you see now. And I think partly because most people in China would say, what, are you crazy? Look around here. We still have 500 million peasants. You know, we'll deal with them and we'll worry about the rest of the world later.
At the same time, they've had the largest entry into the middle class in the history of civilization.
Right. It's true. And I think that is something that is so dramatic to see. You go to these factories in southern China, and factories where 100,000 people work, 250,000, which I've seen, they're incredible. And you see this transformation, and you also see who is left, those in the countryside who still haven't made that leap.
When you ask Chinese, what do they say?
I think
they say it's the dichotomy.
It's a combination of the complexity we would have now about American politics. I personally don't like much about American politics right now, but I'm a very loyal American.
Right,
I have faith in America.
Right.
I think most people in China, they can give you a million complaints about things they don't like, and yet in their own family's life, they remember their grandmothers with bound feet, and they remember their father who might have died in the Cultural Revolution or something, and they have a job and they have a car and all that, so life has been getting better for most people. So I think most people think the system is working.
This idea of not respecting copyright, is that changing?
It is changing really, really slowly. I had the experience once, 25 years ago, I went to give a lecture in front of the Chinese general military staff, and they gave me this nice leather-bound copy of a book I had written, and of course I never had rights assigned to China, but it was translated into Chinese by the general staff.
I said, well, thank you for the Chinese rights.
And the pirate video store is closed down only when there's a U.S. trade mission in town. The rest of the time, they're wide open.
Join us online at charlierose.com.